we have a bunch of free groups and obviously YouTube, and you see the comments people leave on your channel and my channel, whatever. And it's like, how do I market my business? How do I get my phone to ring? It starts with a commitment. You have to understand, you have to be all in. And if you're not willing to take $10 to $15 out of every 100 that comes in and invest it back into marketing, I don't think you're serious about growing your business. Now, listen, you've watched my channel. You know that sometimes I get a little extreme in the things that come out of my mouth. I'm about to get extreme.
Woo, let's do this. Today I have on a really awesome guest that I caught his information, grabbed onto it. His show is, his channel is The Contractor Fight, and I just loved every minute of it. So I wanted to have him on and talk about some of these important points and get his perspective. Tom, would you introduce yourself?
Hey, what's going on, man? I appreciate you having me here. And all that pressure now, you're like, you really liked me and now I got to be good today. Shit. Hey, I'm Tom Reber. I'm founder of The Contractor Fight. In short, we help bring respect and dignity back to the trades. And we do that by helping guys get their heads right and making their wallets a little thicker and, building the type of teams and cultures that are worthy of respect. And so here we are, man. That's our gig.
One of my missions is to inspire other people and inspire them to do more and know that it's out there. And that's why I felt like it was so important to try to get you on here. And just so happened that I made a video that released yesterday on how to grow a business to a million and beyond faster. Yeah. And I had 5 points, and I wanted to get your take on these and kind of just use them to start a little bit of conversation. So I'll run through them the way I listed them and maybe.
All right. Well, to be fair, I have not seen the video yet. So there you go. So we're good.
Tom, what's your take on how important is marketing a business? Because we know we hear all these people that grow by referral and this and that. So give me your take.
You know, sales is oxygen, and you don't get a sale if you don't have a lead, right? I started a painting company a million years ago, and it started because this guy at church, I heard through the grapevine, he was getting his house painted. I was on the bubble of starting my own painting business. And I tapped him on the shoulder. Long story short, I sold him a $10,000 job that should have been 30. The next door neighbor, you know, saw me working, and they walked over and they asked me a question. Next thing I know, I'm doing their deck and I'm painting the front of the house and a couple things inside. And, you know, and it just seemed like that those first couple months were just like that. Everybody that knew me wanted to support me and, you know, being new in business. And then after those couple months passed by and kind of worked through all the people that, you know, knew that you were in business, I woke up really quick to the fact that, holy crap, I don't have any leads. I don't have any jobs. In fact, I didn't even use the term leads back then. I was so ignorant that I didn't even think in terms of like marketing. I had no website. I think I had a metal yard sign I paid $80 for. So then I did what I think I do best, and I just started knocking doors. I'd see a dumpster and I'd be like, hey, you got something going on in the house and I paint shit, so we should probably know each other. That was like my line, right?
Yeah.
And I'd see a contractor driving down the road in a van. I'd literally call the phone number on the van. I would go, hey, it looks like you build nice stuff. I paint stuff. Should we know each other? That was as simple as it was. That was my marketing plan. And it was really tough. Really tough, because that just wasn't enough.
Yeah.
In fact, I've done some videos and podcasts in the past where I estimate that in my first 3 years of business, I easily cost myself a couple million dollars because I did not, this is even more micro than the big marketing thing here. I didn't have a customer database. Like, I'd paint your house and I'd never talk to you again. I wouldn't put your information anywhere. I wouldn't have nothing like that. Grew from zero to like between 300 and 400 jobs within our first 3 years. I mean, just think about the number of projects that is.
Oh yeah.
Just with pure hustle. And I was working a lot harder than I needed to, because I didn't stay in touch with my database, didn't even have a database, didn't even know I was supposed to have one. Dude, I didn't have a website. I had no marketing plan. I had nothing. Let me asterisk this real quick. If you're like a handyman or a one-man show and you like doing the thing that you do, you like the tools, maybe your spouse works, maybe you got $5 million sitting in the bank somewhere and you just like going out and building shit and fixing or painting or whatever, and you don't really want to grow and scale the business, and whatever comes, then word of mouth is great. Be that guy. You know what I mean? But like most people that start a business, they want to grow this damn thing. And they want to have something to show for it. Word of mouth, as great as it is not enough. In fact, for every 100 leads that came into our company, about 80 of them were past customers, influencers, and referrals.
Yep.
And so only 20 of them were we getting out of roughly 20 out of 100, but we needed that 20. We have a bunch of free groups and obviously YouTube, and you see the comments, people leave on your channel and my channel, yep, whatever. And it's like, how do I market my business? How do I get my phone to ring? It starts with a commitment. You have to understand, you have to be all in. And if you're not willing to take, I believe in your first few years of business, $10 to $15 out of every 100 that comes in, yeah, and invest it back into marketing, I don't think you're serious about growing your business.
If you're content with doing this in a small show, because you just run out of fuel so fast. Mm-hmm. If you're not, referrals are a piece and there's a bunch of little pieces that you, right, have to put together, and you have to keep the pedal down. You need to make sure that those leads are always pouring in no matter what.
They don't understand the power of what I call an influencer. So to me, if I'm a painting contractor, an influencer is a guy who does carpet or hardwood, or an interior, yep, designer, a realtor, people that are standing in front of my ideal client hundreds of times a year. I have math here. It's somewhere on my computer here. Hold on. I just had it up. I got to pull this up. I got to share this with you because this is good shit. Oh, wouldn't you know it? I got it on the other computer. All right. Anyway, so I just bought a new Mac and I'm on my old one now. Basically, my goal is to have these influencers, maybe I got three or four realtors, I got a couple home inspectors. If they all give you one lead a quarter. The math I did with like four, I want to say it was 40 influencers, or wasn't even that, 20 or 30 influencers. If your average job size is $5,000, you're going to close like 80% of the influencer leads, because, yep, there's crazy trust built up there. And depending on your job size, I mean, we did anywhere from $500,000 to $750,000 a year just on a few influencer relationships. And so to me, that's got to be part of it. And the other part here, now listen, you've watched my channel, you know that sometimes I get a little extreme in the things that come out of my mouth. Okay. All right. I'm about to get extreme. If you want to grow your business and you don't spend at least what you spent on your fucking truck each year on marketing, you're not serious about growing your business. That usually wakes people up. Man, I spent $60,000. My mirrors were $12,000 alone. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, and so guys will go out and drop $60,000 on a truck, but, yeah, they'll bitch about a $15,000 website that's, yep, going to get them job after job after job. They bitch about their SEO guy. The worst thing they do is they have their wife make their logo for them. Sure, your wife is a great person and she might have been an artist in college or something, but doesn't mean that she understands design and the psychology of design and, yeah, colors and all this other shit. And if she does, great. She's one of like the three wives on the planet that can make the logo for a contract. And it's the same with doing your books, right? I've ranted on that a lot. Like, hire a professional, or we try to build our own website. And fine, if you're in the beginning stages, you don't have any money, all right, you got to get something up there. I get it.
Yep.
But man, charge enough so you can have money to invest back into the company so that you can market this thing like a boss and not half-ass it.
I can't agree with any of that more. I mean, it's so important. And you touched on the next two points just by how serious that point is. In my second one, you've already said it. There's a lot of analogies for this, but how important is sales to follow that up?
Well, it's blood, right?
And
it's
oxygen. And being a professional.
Sales is one of those things that we think we're good at until we really learn what it means to be good at sales. And being good at sales is not, like, I'm extroverted. I can knock on a door and that's not sales. That's, yeah, hunting. Just because you're talkative, just because you might have some charisma and, you're likable, doesn't mean you're a good salesperson. And on the flip side, somebody who's introverted and reserved does not mean they can't be a good salesperson. Mm-hmm. And so sales is really about asking great questions and then shutting your damn mouth. It's that simple. In our sales academy, we have a five-step process. And the first step is called the motive. Why does somebody want to do the project? Mm-hmm. Now, they'll say, oh, I want to make my house or my yard look better, or I want to do this. But there's usually a deeper motive. And, yeah, most of us make assumptions in the sales process, mm-hmm, which is why we sit up at 11 o'clock or 1 in the morning. We negotiate against ourselves that our price is too high. And then we cut $300 off the bid to get it under that 1,000, under the $12,000 to 11,900. So it's an 11 instead of a 12. And, yeah, then we hit send. This is a true story. I negotiated against myself, made assumptions that my price was too high. They were going to have a problem with my price. And I was stressed all night about it. And they text me or email me back in the morning. They're like, hey, it's a go, man. This is great. We thought it was going to be over $20,000.
It's like, the worst feeling in the, yeah, world.
We bring a lot of our own baggage, our own beliefs about money, our beliefs about why people should hire us. That's what we call the tap dance, right? We go out to their yard and we're like, we're really awesome and we don't subcontract and we have this certification and we won this Chamber of Commerce Award and I want all those things too. And that's great. And we've all the certifications. We're making the assumption that that shit's important to the customer. In fact, you know, when you learn how to ask a really good question, you'll understand that the most important thing in hiring a contractor is the fact that their 88-year-old dad with emphysema lives with them and they're afraid that he doesn't die because of the dust that's created on the job. You know, the woman who many years ago had twins and they only slept from like 1:30 to 3 in the afternoon. It was like the only time her kids would sleep. And when we really got to, yeah, she wanted her house done and all this other stuff. But, and I'll give you guys a couple great questions to get their motive here. I just simply asked, I said, hey, you're going to hire somebody to do this job. And we had already talked about the typical shit, right? And then just something told me to take it deeper. And I said, you're going to hire somebody to do this project. They're going to come in. Sure, the work's going to be great. You're going to write them a check. They're going to pull out of your driveway and they're going to leave and drive off into the sunset. So I always try to paint that picture, right? I said, how are you going to know you hired the right guy? Without missing a beat, never came up in the half hour conversation that we had. Mm-hmm. She goes, if you don't wake my twins up, I hired the right guy. And this is where most of us pounce. We go, oh, well, we won't wake them up and we'll be really quiet. And we're really, or if they say, don't leave a mess, we pounce on that. We never leave a mess. We always clean. Instead of barfing on them and pouncing, just pull back. And I said, that's an interesting response. I've never heard that before. I just acknowledged it. And she says, yeah, this is the only time I can sleep and I can do anything for myself is like this hour and a half every day. I don't know what's up with my kids. And I just simply said, hey, you know, would it make sense if we adjusted our start time an hour or so later? We adjusted our lunch a bit and we went off site every day for lunch for an hour and a half. And we'll do some other things and have our company meeting or whatever we have to do. You might take another day or two to get the job done, but would that help you? And she goes, you do that, you got the job. Because that was the true motive. Sales is a skill that can be learned and it takes practice, just like, you know, the golfer goes to the driving range pretty much every day. Yep. Salesperson should be going and doing some role play and getting some sort of training every day as well. And that's one more thing with the sales process. You understand their motive, but this is just a thing that works for us and hundreds of other contractors. We don't ever go to somebody's home without one of two things happening. Number one, they've agreed to write a consultation fee, or they know they're going to be writing a check for a deposit. And we've been doing this for about 6 years, even before all this Corona stuff and the virtual sales, like time that you can save just by learning how to find somebody's motive and just talk budget a little bit. Mm-hmm. That's just two of the five steps will save you gobs and gobs of time if it's done with the right spirit and tonality.
Well, that leads, and you hit on this too. You went so wide on
everything's connected, man.
How important is a quality now? And here, this goes back to, if you want to grow, how important is a quality software that allows you to delegate, keep track of things, and run your business?
Well, I think it's massively important. Problem is that we just don't use it, right? Probably get this too. People ask, hey, what's the best software? What's the best CRM? And my answer is the one you use.
Yep.
Is the best one. Over the past several years, this has gotten a lot better, but way long ago when I first got into CRMs and stuff, they were all built for like white collar industries, right? And long sales cycles and companies that are selling millions of dollars of software packages to other companies and things like that. They were just too cumbersome. And over the past several years, there's been a lot of programs that have come out that are really geared towards a contractor. Just have to commit. Pick one and commit. You know, a million years ago, my painting company doing sales and stuff, I kept my CRM minimized. I had a tablet and I just kept it minimized. And whenever I was talking to somebody, if I sold a job, if I got a lead, whatever it was, I just bring it up. And I just got in the habit of just filling it out. And when you do, most guys wait till the end of the day, most guys wait till the end of the week. There's an old saying in marketing and sales, money's in the list. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly what I was talking about earlier, is I had zero information. And here's the thing. Number one, when somebody gives you money, they're more likely to do it again. And there's percentages like 80% more likely or some shit like that, right? Two, when somebody doesn't buy from you, it doesn't mean they hate you, you were too much money or whatever. You don't know. Sometimes they ghost you, they disappear, and then you follow up or they reach back out to you and they go, hey, is that bid still good? My mother-in-law died and it's been a crazy 3 months. Okay, life happens. And if we're not staying in touch with people, I mean, you paid to get the phone to ring. You gave your time or your money, right? You gave your time or your money or both to get the fucking phone to ring. You take that lead and you never heard from them. They didn't buy from you. And you're like, screw you. And you light it on fire and throw it away.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just stupidity, because there's crazy data out here, but sometimes people hire the wrong contractor and a year later they call you to do the service or whatever it is, or to fix the mistake. I'm amazed at how many of my clients in the past didn't know other services that we did. Gosh, I'm telling you, I'm driving. I did about $60,000 of interior painting for this woman once. Cruising down the road one day, I'm happy. You know, it's a spring day. The windows are down. I'm smiling. Long hair is blowing in the breeze. Now, and I see this painting crew out, and they're at her house, and they're painting the exterior. I'm like, what the hell? So I call her. I'm like, hey, it's Tom. She's like, oh, hi. You know, like nothing's wrong. And I'm like, are you mad at me? She's like, no, why? So I've been to your house like five times, painted the inside. And you got so-and-so, who was my biggest competitor at the time, painting your exterior. She goes, well, I didn't know you painted exteriors. And that's when I learned to do the did you know communication, right? Yeah. Leave behinds on job sites, or, you know, email, you know, marketing things like, hey, did you know that we also do this? Building a database, having a good CRM is going to help you do all these things, but you got to commit. Just start, because you're going to figure it's just like anything else. Yeah. Marketing, sales, playing guitar, riding a bike. You're going to figure things out along the way, but you have to commit. You have to start. Quit being lazy about it. Exactly. And just make it happen.
The only thing that I'd even add is, obviously, that the best point, one of the points I loved was, you know, just the one you use is a great CRM.
Right.
The only thing that I like to look for is the ability, if you're wanting to grow, how well will it scale with your company? Because I see so many people wanting to use the free thing because it doesn't, it's free.
Yeah.
You know, not spend $70 to $150 a month on something that they never have to change. Because if you get your database built and then you have to migrate your database, you'll wish you never made that small mistake.
Exactly. You know, my biggest complaint about CRMs for contractors, and I think it's just because we have a quick sales cycle for the most part, unless you're a home builder or whatever, but this is personal opinion. I'm sure there's things out there that work. When it comes to leads and lead tracking and sales tracking, I've actually always preferred a spreadsheet. It's where a lot of guys get hung up. They get a CRM because they want to start tracking their leads or something, and the CRMs make it a little too complicated.
I don't know. Well, we'll roll right into these next ones, and these two that I don't know how you feel on. So how important is a coach? How important is someone to help basically mentor you and get you pointed in the right direction from an outside perspective?
Well, you know, I am a coach. So that's, you know, you're kind of setting me up there to say, hey, coaches are great. But I do believe they are, because you can learn. I mean, everything that comes out of a coach's mouth, for the most part, you can generally find for free somewhere in the world, right? But I think if you want to move faster, you hire a coach who has a proven history of working with people and getting them the results that you want. It's somebody who's not emotionally attached, because when we're emotionally attached to a lot of the decisions we have to make in our business or our own bullshit, you know, we lie to ourselves. And so a coach is outside, not emotionally attached, can see the things that you can't see. I think somebody who's been around the block a little bit, who understands maybe marketing a little better, or whatever, they can kind of see around the bend. Because of my experience of screwing up my database stuff early on, I can see around the bend, and that's actually made people millions of dollars because I have that wisdom now, right? You know, you got to have a coach that you're going to resonate with, that you have a chemistry with, that speaks your language. And I think coaches are great. You just got to find the one that works for you. I know I'm not a fit for everybody. I'm a little rough around the edges, but it really just depends on what you want too. Like, I think one of the biggest mistakes people make when they hire a coach is they don't have absolute clarity on the outcome they're looking for. They just go, I want my business to get better.
Yep.
So I'm going to hire a business coach.
Mm-hmm.
And I always push and go, well, what aspect of your business? Well, every aspect. Okay, well, which one's first? You know, like if you had to rank them, and we always start with the mindset. It always starts with what's between our ears. That's what the whole contractor fight is about. But then we typically in our process, and I'm not pitching our process, but we typically go, fix your mind, get your mind where it needs to be. Then let's take care of the oxygen, meaning you got to make money. We got to put points on the board, marketing and sales, so that you can pay yourself. So when you're working those long hours and you go home, you at least feel like you're making some progress because you're paying yourself. Most of us, all this money comes into our business and we divvy it out and we're left holding like $4. And we're like, what the hell just happened? We allow everyone else to get fed before we get fed. or get oxygen or whatever you want to talk about. What I want to encourage guys is make sure that you're working with a coach. I've worked with coaches personally, many of them. I had one many years ago where they were all about building infrastructure of the business, but there was very little emphasis on the mindset and very little emphasis on you getting your own. And so I just think make sure that you're working with somebody who understands the mental game, how important it is to get clarity on specifically what you, like if you're making kick butt money right now and marketing is good, but maybe you're not happy with your close rate, then get some sales training. My first year of business, I had like 50 grand left in the bank at the end of the year. And I was like, how the hell did that happen? Right? I had no idea. It just happened because I was hustling. I knew nothing about the books. I knew nothing about break even and gross profit and all this other shit. So I had to get some coaching on that. I just didn't get specific. And then I understand this coach, not every coaching relationship should be forever because you evolve, you grow. Mm-hmm. We have people that come into our programs and they're like, you know, I've tapped them on the shoulder. I think you're done here. And they're like, what? And I'm like, no, I think you're done. Like we've hit the goals that you've wanted to hit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So what's next for you?
Well, I got one more and we'll keep it quick because I know you don't have much time. And this is something that's been monumental, pushed me more towards coaching and everything as of the past year. But how important is obviously continued learning, but with an emphasis on, you know, actually getting out and going to conferences, seeing other people that are driven and using that to get, you know, mindset. Grant Cardone's one I'm big on, and Tony Robbins, you know, I've been going to at least one of their events every year.
For me, what's at the root of an event is being around other people.
Yes.
They're like, you know, so we could do it like you and I are doing now. We could do it in small groups. It doesn't have to be a big stadium. I have had the most growth in my life because I chose to get in the room with more successful people. One of the turning points in my life was several years ago. I had a friend who he was part of a nonprofit organization. It was for college guys that it was this leadership thing, Academy, founded by this one of the guys, a guy named Jerry Nelson, who started Ticketmaster. He dug in the desert. Now we have Scottsdale. He's owned 44 companies. Super, super cool guy. He wanted to have an impact. So he started this leadership thing and then it grew, blah, blah, blah. And make a long story short, I ended up going and being a breakout speaker at one of their events several years ago. I didn't want to go. I said no, I think 2 years in a row. Mm-hmm. To my buddy, I made some excuse that I couldn't go. The year that I went, I was like, I got to get over this fear of mine because my fear was that I was stupid. I didn't do well in school. I rode the short bus for 2 years, literally in grade school. I was in learning disabled class or whatever you want to call it. And so I had this baggage that I was just stupid. I wasn't smart. I couldn't compete intellectually. So that was at the root of why I didn't go to that thing. Cause it was this college fraternity event. I didn't finish college. Yeah. It was all these smart guys in my mind, right?
Yeah.
And I didn't want to put myself in the middle of that and be exposed as a fraud like I'm stupid. Anyway, I chose to walk into the punch. I went there and I walked in the room and the most amazing thing happened. Not really. I walked in the room and I look over on the wall and they had everyone's bios up on the wall. Jerry Nelson is like 17 pages of all his accomplishments and the billionaire in the oil industry and the guy who owns the lumber company and my buddy who owns this $60 million company and all his other garbage. And then it gets to me and it's like three sentences, you know, Tom had a painting company and he was a Marine and, you know, United States Marine and he's here. Just like, and I didn't even read everything. I just see the length of everyone's bios on the wall. And so the first thing I saw when I walked in this room, I looked and just from afar, I'm just like, yeah, you're just not that impressive. You're a dumb shit. Fast forward to the end of the week, the guys on the board, all these massively successful guys asked me to sit in on their board meeting to talk about how they were going to market the event in the future. Mm-hmm. I sat down, I took some notes, and just in case they asked me what I was thinking, I would at least know what I was thinking. We're almost out of there, and billionaire guy says, hey, let's get out of here. And this other dude who owns this massively huge lumber company goes, well, Tom's new here. Tom, what do you think we should do? And I went, shit. And in about 40, 45 seconds, I just kind of rattled off some of the bullet points. Hey, if I were in charge of marketing this thing, this is what I would do. Billionaire guy looks at his assistant or some dude that's there with him and goes, do we have the capability to do all that? And the guy goes, yeah. He goes, all right, let's do that. Meeting adjourned. They all got up and walked away. I'm sitting there at this table overlooking the South China Sea, or not South, the Sea of Cortez. Thinking of the Philippines there for a minute. And the sun's going down. And God's honest truth, I walked out on this gorgeous patio, this huge compound. cracked open a beer. I looked out at the sun. I had tears in my eyes, and I actually said out loud to myself, you're not stupid. And that moment changed my life and my career and my bank account and everything, because it gave me the mojo. And it all started because I decided to go to an event.
That is awesome.
Get myself in the room where I wasn't the smartest guy. And yes. And that's actually one of the hardest things for me about being a coach, is everybody's always coming to me. Mm-hmm. And I have to be really intentional about making sure that I'm reaching out to people that know more than me or more successful than me and things like that. And because otherwise it goes to our head and we think we're all that, and we're really not. But I would encourage people, get in the room with people. You know, I don't know who said it first, but if you're the smartest one in the room, you're the wrong room, right?
And I was waiting for the point to put that slide that in. But you already stole it from me. All right.
Most of us, we don't go to these things because we don't know. And, you know, we didn't have the money. Okay, I'm broke. I've gone to events where I put it on a credit card that I had to use two credit cards to pay for the fucking event, right? Yeah. And, you know, I've slept in my car. I've, you know, instead of avoiding a hotel room or something, just to be around certain people. And so this comes back to investing in yourself. Everything we're talking about here, marketing and sales and your CRM and a coach and events, it's all really at the end of all this, it's about you and taking your time and money, investing in you, taking some action.
100%. I love the whole premise you put on that. If you don't have it right up here, you won't have it right anywhere.
Yeah.
So many of these things hit on that. Well, Tom, thank you so much for coming on. That was my five. How do you feel like I did on 5 points?
You did good, man. You did really good. Cool. I'm trying to think if I'd add anything.
That's what I wanted to add.
I think really just becoming a people expert. If you want to scale your business, you know, we kind of touched on that in sales, but really understand people. The whole labor shortage in the trades is really, really tough. And it has been for a long time. And I think it has been for a few reasons. One, our country's been telling you go to college, right? Yeah. Forever.
Yeah.
And if you don't go to college, you're a moron and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Number two, most contractors are great at the craft, great people, but most don't make the money they should be making. And it's real. And financially, it's not that attractive. Like you're tired, you're dirty, and you're broke. Why would anyone want to look at their dad or their uncle or whatever and follow in those footsteps? Mm-hmm. So I think it's, and then the third is most of us take the leadership qualities or skills that we learned from our dads, like me, who'd walk on the job site and he was a ball buster, right?
Yeah.
And sometimes you got to kick people in the tail and stuff, but if that's your default way of leading your team, you're really going to struggle. So I think it really comes down to really understand what makes your people tick and, you know, build the type of culture that is attractive to others. But none of that, all that's harder if you're not marketing and selling and all the other things that we talked about. So it's different stages.
Awesome.
But no, man, I think you knocked it out of the park.
Thank you so much for coming on. This is awesome. Is there any shout outs to any of the things you're doing that you want to throw out here at the end?
Listen, I just appreciate you having me on. You know, we have our Contractor Fight TV channel on YouTube and a Contractor Fight podcast, bunch of stuff. We got a great free Facebook group. You know, anyone can hop on there. If somebody wants to learn how to make sure they're pricing their work right, they can go to thecontractorfight.com/50. And that's in honor of the 50% gross profit that we encourage people to get. That means you do a $10,000 job and only cost you $5 to do. You got $5 left. Mm-hmm. And that's the fastest way to put some more money in your pocket.
Awesome. Well, thank you again. Everyone, thank you for watching. We'll see you all soon.
Appreciate you, man.